Thanks again for staying with me on the program TMI Monday. Now let's talk budgets and impacts on governance in Nigeria, looking at the key challenges. I have with me in the studio a legal practitioner, a civil society activist, the executive director, Freedom of Information Council, Barrister Prest Agboha. Many thanks for joining us, Barrister
Agboha. Thank you for the invite.
Okay. One major thing that one can see within the context of Nigeria is that you can't really marry budget estimates and the tangible, feelable impacts of governance. Why is there this disconnect?
First and foremost, we have to first establish what budgeting means. Budgeting is a financial plan for a period, most appropriately a year. Now, the question specifically is that the people that are not being, that are not participating in the budget, right from its drawing out, the scheming of those projects and the fees attached to it, there is no public hearing for the people to come and say this is what actually we want. What happens is that government governors or the president as it is, or local government chairman as it is, brings whatever they think is appropriate for the people and fees a price tag. Rather than defending the budget as it is, they just put it before the House, and the House passes it. It's only the National Assembly you see that they reduce the figures. And people are saying that it's not constitutional, they don't have the power. If they don't have the power, what other power do they have? If you have a child who says, okay, I need 20,000, and the judge comes and I need 20,000, and it comes to only defend the 20,000 that are before you, what role do you now have? You also have your role to say, no, you don't. This is not the priority. This is the priority. Let's remove it. Let's add it. So those powers are there, even if it's not clearly stated. The people are completely cut off because we're in a representative democracy. That's the second reason.
Okay.
Representative democracy is expected that I'm being represented in National Assembly, I'm being represented in State of Assembly, I'm being represented in the Council for those who have been elected to be there. So in representative democracy, it's expected that those who are in the House of Assembly speak the mind of their people. So that also means that they should have ward meetings, they should have town hall meetings to know what exactly do the people want? What does that do my people want? And what does it cost? And I haven't gathered that. You not bring it into the State House of Assembly's budget,
okay,
and make sure that it is passed in that particular sector of local government. But in this case, what the people are caught at is that the persons in the Federal House of Assembly or National Assembly thinks that they are through with them until the next 4 years.
Interesting. So you are putting this blame squarely at the doorsteps of the legislators,
yes,
both at the federal, state, and local government.
Yes.
Can you substantiate that?
The role of a legislator is to pass, part of the role, to pass budget and make laws. Don't also forget, budget is a law.
Yeah.
When it is passed, it's a law. So if your role is to pass a law, and you require the input of the people, and you don't get that input, there's a presumption that all is well, if it is well. When it fails, it fails because you are negligent. And if there are no serious projects to your community, and this community is denied of water, and you have to have put it in the budget, or you inflated the budget and all the rest, it is your job. And if there's a governor that takes the House of Assembly as putty, that this House of Assembly are there, they got a thing by it because I supported them and all that, and they're in the House, they have to act by script. It is at your deficit. If your persons are not being, your project are not imputed in the budget of the state, the citizens in your locality are not benefiting, they should be responsible because it is what? A representative democracy. They can't speak for themselves. They can only speak minimally from cluster groups like NGOs, like other big organizations that can make one or two imputes. But those who represent you, those should be held liable for not putting your interest forward are those who directly are elected in various houses of assembly. You cannot hold the judge liable because the judiciary is another arm. You cannot also directly hold the executive who is the executive. You can only now say the executive are negligent if it is already in the budget,
yeah,
and they didn't do it.
Yeah.
They now have to now tell you why they could not perform such obligation,
okay,
against the fact that they fly private jet for fake meetings.
Mm.
So if they can pay 30 million for just to fly to Abuja and they cannot do something on 25 million, you don't have a statutory duty to not even ask the executive to do their job, or maybe use civil society groups to approach the court to question various arms of government to account for such wrongful spendings.
All right. What do you make of the thinking that there are some bottlenecks in various MDAs which also is responsible for this seeming lack of impacts of budget in the lives of the citizens?
I don't agree with that. At the federal level, it seems so. Or at the state, I've never heard that the state says that, okay, we have some sort of amount budgeted for this year and we cannot finish it. That has never been in news at the subnational, at the state level. It's only in the federal. Now, I heard that first 2 years of Buhari reception. After that, you know that they leak it before they push the next budget. You get the point? So, because these are experts.
Well, what do you mean they leak it?
They finish the money. No reserve. So, in the states, that's what happens. Only the federal government started hearing in 2016. There's money. We can't finish it. This particular agency. But now, before the first 7 months, they already preparing the budget for another year. A budget that was passed in March, I can tell you 70% gone. I'm getting it now. So there is no bottlenecks at the state level. At the federal level, there used to be bottlenecks, but these bottlenecks have since been removed because they were employer experts who will not tell them how to account for it. All this is about receipting. You have 200 million to drill borehole, and you can get a receipt from one consultant that if you paid him 100 million. You get the receipt from another consultant who drilled it, a driller. Said he paid him 100 million. In short, 120 that you're even owing me 20 million. They will also appropriate it again, 2020 again, dealing on board with 20 million. You will not be thinking that this boy is not cheaper. No, they want to pay debt. Are you getting it now? So that's where we are. There's nowhere in this state where they say, okay, the bottleneck. There's no bottleneck anywhere. The problem is that the money appropriated, 60% is going to go to private ports, and 40% will go for the, 30% will go for the work done, and middlemen take the rest.
Okay, there's a trend in terms of the budget estimate year in, year out. Yes. It's always on the increase. Are you concerned about that?
I will shock you with some information from the state. We like to be very specific. And 2018 budget, I will read some out. Let us see if those things are done, if those things are still repeating itself, and why in the first place those things are even in our budget. I start with one heading in the 2018 of Edo State budget. He said there's a committee of food and nutrition.
Food and nutrition.
10 million for that committee. Land Bureau, 20 million. Land Use Charge Office. Land Use Charge Office, 4 million.
Land Bureau, Land Use Charge Office.
Yes. Okay. Edo State Geographical Information System Office, 10 million. At least we know that this one exists.
Yeah.
In Sapley Road. I don't know where the Land Use Charge Office is, that takes 4 million. I don't know where the Land Bureau is. Election Petition Tribunal
has an allocation?
Yes, there's an allocation for them, 50 million. Whooping some of 50 million naira is there for them. They are delivering, they have some part of Germany to deliver today. There's money for them. Edo State Multi-Door Court has 20 million. Edo State Multi-Door Court runs for a year. And what they gave them, 20 million. And Election Petition Tribunal runs for a minimum of a quarter.
Gets 50
million.
What
they are getting, 50 million. And made up of no more than 5 persons. Or maybe 10, including the registrars. Not more than 6, including the registrars, because they use our registrars here to support some. Legal consultancy for the Minister of Justice, 250 million. Minister of Justice passing overhead, general overhead, is 240 million. So consultancy, we can be one consultant, takes money higher than
the
run
the full ministry.
The entire ministry. That's just part of it. If I begin to go into details, you'll be so surprised. That's why it is easy. I'm wondering why probing people, you need receipt. You need to be a governor before you probe. You now need to check files. This budget by its heading is already a probable one. And don't forget, we went to Shomole left office. They proposed that they pay in pension. Those who protested it are the people. The citizens said no, he's not deserving of a pension. He got enough from us. And that should give you an insight into what is in the future. It now means that in the next 1 year, next 2 years, people will begin to ask questions and say, okay, in 2017, 2018, 2019, this is what you got in your, as a budget flow. Can you account for all these figures? Now that you don't have immunity. It therefore means that there will be a lot of litigation against some of these governors who are misappropriating. People will no longer wait for the FCC to begin to select and pick those to prosecute. People now have the power to gather 100 persons in a list of a court and say, okay, we need to ask questions. The issue of local standards has been established.
Okay.
That how did this amount, if the election tribunal took 50 million, it's very easy. It's your colleagues. Let them come and tell us how much really got to them. Why?
And how they spend the money.
How they spend the money. Why did they even collect it? Because these are provided for under NGC. NGC has money for them. They have their transport. They have everything logistics prepared. So these are the problem with our budgeting system. The problem with Nigerians, it's knowledge. I'm waiting for you to settle down, look at things critically, rather than running up and down, making a lot of noise. These budgets are in a public domain. During the last administration, it made it a public thing. The reason is not because he loves you when he loves his administration. He want to be secret also. But it is a demand to get World Bank loan that you must put your budget
in the public domain.
Yes, SFTAS. Are we getting it now? SFTAS test. It must be there. If you write it to them, they check it. Once it's there, yes, you have fulfilled one of the key obligations. You now have to also pass fiscal transparency law that they just passed in 2018. You have to pass all those things now to get those
loans.
Yes, to get those loans. So
now all of these things, they are supposed to act as checks and balances and ensure there is transparency and accountability. But it looks like it's a case of the more you look, the less you see.
Yes,
because it really doesn't bring.
Yeah, the essence of the law in itself is not for you to check them. The essence of the law in itself is not for you to know what they are doing. As I speak to you now, there's no public copy of a those state public finance and management law 2018. There's no public copy. Only very few of us have the copy. There's no public copy for it. So they don't expect you to have it. They don't expect you to know. They have one section in that law, section 68. It stops the public from knowing what they are doing. They said if you want to know how much you spend in this and on that, you must show receipt of your tax. Are you seeing it now? So the essence of all these things is just to grab the money, and they now added that section there. Don't try to use this law. If you don't have a copy of your tax receipt.
But again, let's look at it.
Have to say that citizens should pay tax. Do we vote with it? The citizens who have voted you there have an obligation to know what you are doing. Information is too minimal for us to begin to ask for your capacity to ask. It's a minimal thing, like asking you your name. So, okay, give me your ID card. But I'm just asking you your name. I'm not asking you your address. So, no, show me your ID card first before you what? Know my name. So, this the bar being set by this law that they pass is also questionable. But the good news is that we are already in court on that matter. That the law, that section
should be expunged.
Yes.
Okay, now I talked about the seeming yearly increase in the budget.
Yes.
I mean, particularly at the federal level, I'm sure even at some states, you have it that way. You never find a time where, for example, 2018 budget or 2019 budget is lower than 2018. It's always on the ascendancy. You want to give some thoughts along this line?
It will always be on the increase, because when you enter office, the numbers of persons that you have to satisfy will continue to increase as the years go by. You're getting it? So, and also forget, when somebody enters office for the first time, there's this innocency. Try to understand the templates. By the time it's there for 4 years, it's going to come back in the next 8 years. And let me not use the word wounded lion, but much more abreast with the way the system works. That there is no what? Accountability check mechanism. Oh, that I put in 30 million to feed orphans. Nobody asked for orphans. Have you identified numbers of orphans in the state? I've given them 30 million. How was the disbursement strategy? Nobody asked. So that means I can actually add 50 to it. So you add 50 to it and say 50 million, 80 million for orphans and widows. Nobody will ask. You add another 50 to it in the next third year of the office, that 120 million for orphans, widow, and seeking fathers who are sick. Nobody asks. And he go to the central hospital to visit some of his friends, give them 2 million, 1 million. They say, they show him, even on your television. And the governor was in the UBTA to give money to accident victims. And nobody asked him, this is 130 million. Is it 2 million that got to us? Thank you, sir. They don't know. So he said, okay. In the next 4 years, take it to 4 million. So the truth is that the information level the knowledge level is not there. We have persons who have the capacity to speak, who have the capacity to make their point. But the information that you need to make this conclusion, an argument, a confrontation is not there, is there, but not they don't assess it. So the citizen should take, it's too high for you to say, oh, I want to have this in the budget, I want to have this in the budget. First of all, go and study what is contained in their budgets and begin to ask questions along that line. Begin to ask questions along that line, begin to make some suggestions. Like, okay, if you have 30 million for this, why not build develop a school in the state, a good roof, well-equipped school, free for orphans. Free for orphans. If you don't know what to do with it, this is what you should do with it.
I thought this was some of the things the Freedom of Information Bill was supposed to address.
Yes, we have used it excellently in this state to be able to canvass fiscal transparency and institutional building. But we had a clerk from the same state, at the Court of Appeal, where they said, the law does not apply to us. The law does not apply to us. And when they said that, one bank gave them the threshold that if you are not using Freedom of Information, what law are you not using? They now want to pass Public Management and Finance Law 2018. But now said, these people, they will come and use this law to ask questions. So let them show their tax particulars. Are you getting it now? So you work so hard to get this thing excellently done, but the system will resist you. But the persistent, keep on doing it bit by bit. And before you know it, the orientation and the awareness will go around and the whole state will be
What are your thoughts on the challenge of a seeming prioritization of certain areas at the detriment of other areas? Say, for example, security. I saw a post recently on one of the social media platforms where they gave a figure for the National Assembly, and then they gave a figure for security, particularly the police, in terms of budget.
Yes.
While the one for the National Assembly was given 100%, that of the police was just within the region of about maybe 20% or thereabouts. Mm. And that seems to be replicated in different aspects of the budget. What do you make of this?
The budget is there. The appropriation is there. And don't forget, you must need the money. Are you getting it now? You cannot go to the general and say, like this, give me 20 million there. You won't put it on paper. What actually do you need it for and all that? So if don't forget that these persons who occupy such office are just there, and anytime they wake up, they think, they will sustain themselves there. Oh, they won't remove me this week. Oh, protest or shite. Who make them sack me? That's what's bothering them, not the police college in Ikeja. Are you getting it now? So the state of police college in Ikeja, the commissioner of police in charge of there, cannot even send tests to him. They say, there are the leaky roof. There are these, there are, I can't send tests because say, I don't know what the IG would think. Is even, who is even expecting some returns from you? And you come to CP briefing, original police briefing. I start telling him that this one is leaking, that one is leaking. You have your role to play, which you know. Are you getting it now? So if it doesn't settle down to actually do administration and operation and the political aspect of it, which is that you meet the president, you go and visit him in Salah, you go and visit the wife so that your office will be sustained and all that. But if you takes 90% of your office, there's every tendency that you can't access that money.
Absolutely.
Because you must show what you need it for. You need the CP in Lagos to tell you, we need this is the looking roof. You need to tell you how much it is. You need to show photograph and all that before you apply for it. So not accessing that money, you and I know, it's not a function of the states. It's a function of the fact that it is not a priority for the leadership. They are priority as it is, and it has always been, is that they want to be in office almost forever.
I once heard the former president, Dr. Goodluck Jonathan, who was in Benin yesterday to honor the SMR of Benin on the occasion of his 85th birthday. He said something that in his own ideology about fighting corruption, make the monies inaccessible to those who would literally steal this money. But from the thoughts that you've conversed here, it looks like our budgeting structure encourages corruption.
Yes, the budget is, you want to be a rich man today. A lot of people would think that going to politics makes you a rich man. Go to politics and contest. It's not really true now. But what you do, because the way the budgeting is be a contractor, a stash native contractor with a briefcase, with a CAC certificate. Because the budgeting is skewed towards benefiting businessmen. Because even the core politician, before he can make money, he needs businessmen, he needs the Bureau of the Exchange, he You need the drillers. You need the construction men. You need those who have rigid CDC. You need those who have tractors.
Service providers.
You got that service provider, then you run the money through them. So if you want to be rich now, it's not really going to be a politician. It's to be a good businessman with what? Profile. Account company profile. On how to get these jobs done. So the budgeting is so skewed towards making businessmen more richer. So what did the system need to do? It to streamline it. We need to have cost system. The cost. If you are running a budget of 30 million for this, 20 million for that, there is a natural cost system. The cost system will show you what actually is the cost for such a project. And when the cost system is not, it's at variance with what your budget is, that means that budget heading, it dies automatically. So if those things are there, it makes the businessmen begin to think of doing something else. Maybe being a broadcaster. Are you getting that? So if they change their job and you discover that everything will become same. If you want to know how a system can work and that this money can actually be caged, you go to Abuja now. Those big events that you normally go to, those the gardens that people will be declaring, they are all empty now. You go there, you see the numbers of persons, you can count them. So, good luck system was really a generous one. But the system that we are in now is a system that more Nigerian money is spent abroad. You get to the point now. So you're no longer in the hand of commoners where you can buy beer for people. What you now do is to buy St. Remy in one hotel in London for your friends. Are you getting it now? So the system of the money moved a bit higher than common man's hand and went to a professional career contractors who now execute their deeds in London and in Washington. So that's where we are. So the budgeting system can actually be tailed if it can be run it in a way that the programming can actually work. We have you know what it costs to buy a cement. Somebody say I want to build a house for you, 300 bags of cement. It's just automatic. You know what it means.
You know how much
it needs to pay workmen.
Yes.
You get the point?
Yes.
So it's not like it's coming with a budget. This is what I want. It's coming what he wants to do. And the price just go automatically with it.
All right, let's just look at this other aspect, which of course is the seeming war of words between the states and the local government over funds allocation and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. I remember in the last dispensation, mm-hmm. before this, I mean, the present set of governors came in, there were many of them mm-hmm. who ostracized local government, so to speak. They took control, they took charge. I remember I think it was Rochas Okorocha who had sway for close to 2 years,
yes.
And there was no local government administration and all of that. So what are your thoughts? Because governance is supposed to be about the people, touching the lives of the people. And I know that there's been these discussions and conversations on the fact that we need to have more allocations to the states and then to the local government. What are your thoughts?
Hey, I think the local government boss are the problem to themselves. When you have been appointed from Benin to go and be chairman in Owa, and you know you came from Lagos, your people don't know you. So suddenly 30 million comes, you need 20 million to pay for primary school teachers and your council, the staffs in your office, and you are left with 1.2 million. And there are files in your table that you need to repair one market. You need to go and do some minor jobs in some streets. Your hands are tied. Your hands are tied. You don't even, the next time you go to Benin to see the governor, you still be thanking him for bringing you from Lagos. You're going to become a council chairman in local government that you don't even have a house or perhaps a family house, but you came from there. Are you getting it now? The system in itself is dead because of the way of ascendancy. Are you getting it now? Secondly, the chairman of local government do not see this as a priority. Independence is not a priority to them as far as they are concerned. Until they see it as priority, they will fight for it. If the national chairman of a local government, I don't say one has was one time the chairman, the present commissioner for cooperatives and wealth creation, was one time, if at that time,
Agon chairman, and then challenged Agon president.
Yeah, Agon president. Don't forget, even at that time, one of the best president that they have ever had. I think he even got a national honor from the president.
Yeah.
So if at that time he has used that good way to challenge that issue, okay, that session of the constitution, it's a constitutional issue.
But he did. He did, because I know I covered him extensively well. But you know that there's also a limit to which you can go when you make this engagement and you make this push.
Yes. Yeah, like I'm saying, the if you are taking that matter, to, it's a constitutional matter.
Okay.
It's not a matter that the president will say, oh, good Lord, I'm your friend, though. You know we are friends. Okay, I'll change it. No. It's not a policy issue. It's a constitutional matter. The constitution says, Section 7, is that the federal allocation will send money to states into what we call state joint local government accounts.
Yes.
So when they enter that, the state will not give money to the local government as described by the national, by the state assembly. So the local government chairman, advocacy should be on the House of Assemblies. So House of Assembly, please, let us make this law that this money should not be sent to them. Let the state pass it directly to us. So if that law is there, yes, that is the state cannot directly or indirectly disburse money to them like the children, you get the point?
Yes.
Since we work well, it's a constitutional matter, and a constitutional matter of that nature cannot be solved across the table.
Mm.
They have to, the parties, relevant parties, have to sit down and go to court. If an ordinary citizen goes to court, they will ask, what's your locus in this matter? What's your interest? Are you a council chairman? Do you have a council you are controlling? What's your interest?
But he has a right to challenge that.
He has a right, but this argument that we're saying, what you know, you will do 8 years in court and you won't have a headway. But people are fighting, they have so much money. So you have to be ready, you have the locus to challenge it. So your local government chairman, anyone who are complaining, should sit down and ask themselves and approach the court. So, okay, we want this thing to be changed. It is a constitutional matter. You cannot get it by law. Even if you need that for tomorrow, you can't get it. You must go on. Even the NFIU coming in to say, oh, I want to compel the state, the federal allocation, to send directly to them.
Yes.
They have constitutional limitation. Who empowers them to do that? And there's a matter in court already. Some parties are taking it to court to tell them that you cannot exercise such power. Upon which law are you getting that power from? NFIU just a subsidiary of EFCC. You can't do that. So the point is, it's a constitutional matter. Mm-hmm. Until that issue is solved, we'll be where we are. But another thing that this local government can actually do on their own, and they can be declaring in the public, if you give me 30 million, I say you give me 30 million. If you give me 20, I say you give me 20. Are you getting it now? So the governor in this, my local government in the north did it, but they gave in 7 million. I cannot even cover staff salary. Are you getting it now? When you start declaring it, they will be so ashamed of themselves. And we start taking the local government seriously. Because even in this state as it is now, local government roads are being tied from the state. The state will sit and say, oh, you go and do that road, you go and do that road. The local government are supposed to be the one paying customary court judges.
Mm.
Yet they are taking from the state. Are you getting it now? So those services of local government have been taken from them. So also the profiting of it. And the good argument of state is this.
Mm.
That the local government chairman, they can't even manage the little one you give them, let alone give them
so much.
So they have the onus to clear their part.
Okay, that's a very strong point that you just raised. But let's look at the influence of party politics in all of this conversation. Because I've heard people say, well, if I decide to go on this plank to engage the issues constitutionally, you have some party chairman or some party leader somewhere saying, look, we're supposed to be in the same party. Mm. How come you are doing this against your own party? Mm. What do you make of this?
It is always like that, but in every system, an individual must have his own private principle. Are you getting it now? So when you go into governance and you get so engulfed with a primitive party philosophy, are you getting it now? You will sink with it. If you don't say anything, you die. If you say something, you also die. So basically, it's not a do or die fight. It's very simple. It's an intellectual debate. Let governance be transparent. Let the proceed of the allocation get to the ordinary citizen. And we'll never get to them by sharing plate of food for them. When you allocate something, let it work, go down the line. We have chairman of appropriation, sitters of assembly. These officers are there. They should do their job. And liaising with relevant security agencies like the EFCC, ICPC in the state is okay, please. Want to do this. This is our project for this fiscal year. Help us to utilize it. The chairman of that committee can even, other committees in the House of Assembly, those in health, can go through the budgets. What is available for us in health?
Mm.
You're getting it now? Those in women affairs can go through the budget. What is available for us in women and children?
Yeah.
Let me even drop back in those state budget. What was there for children and the vulnerable? Medical assistance. I don't know for who, 55 million. Sanitation, 10 million. Environmental education. The people should not be educated on what to do. Was upgraded at 2 million. Environmental health hazard. I don't know to who, 3 million. Edo Statewide Management Board, 25 million. Sweeping contract, 33 million.
That's an empowerment.
Yes. Sweeping contract. Yes. Suppose you want to sweep around, 33 million. And Edo State Environmental Protection Agency, 20 million. Agency gets 20 million, but the contractors got 33 million. And we now want to know, do you remember the Edo State Environmental Protection Agency and Edo State Waste
Management
Board, all together totaling 45 million. So the chairman of Environment and Health should have seen this as an opportunity to even before you pass it, you ask questions. But because they don't read it, it looks voluminous for them. And the governor comes to the table and says, okay, this is the budget. All they are interested in is the envelopes that goes with it. And the governor has not even asked that they should hit the gavel on the table. It is done. So the governor looked back and observed that.
These are just personal opinions that you're expressing by some president. It may not be a true reflection of this.
You watch it on your channel. How the budget goes. Mm. But you watch it. I will say that even in the House of in National Assembly, when the budget was presented before, you see the hula balu, you can see the noise. But you see the clandestine, the kind of ambience that the Edo State own will just be passed. And you'll just be surprised. That all of them will wear suit on that day. Are you getting it now? They all wear dress. And you observe that there's no seat that will be empty. They came for what? Is it to debate the budget or to get their own
For the budget presentation by Mr. Governor?
So that's the problem. The problem is that even if you even make the mistake of not even looking through some pages, now that you know, how can you not go to the manager? Oh, this is what you had. So, what are you doing with it? What are your books? Are you getting it now? So it is not about politics. It's just the point that people are not ready to do their
okay. Now, on a final note, you talked about the citizens having the willingness and the drive to know and then following up with action. What are your final perspectives on that?
The citizens should be much more interested. We agree we are in a representative democracy, but democracy is now much more liberalized. We have social media, we have the court, we have the civil society groups. The citizens should, even individual citizens, and actually take us on this campaign. And so this area must be addressed. There are issues around waste management that people are paying for just one small sachet of biscuits. We have to pay 500, 700 to go and dispose it. People are resisting it, saying, no, these things, I can't be paying for it. These are supposed to be what? Local government responsibility to its citizens. Assuming we're not considering that we can even pay a fee, we have to pay it to what local government council. So the citizens must stand up to their rights and make necessary agitation before government. Government do not know it all. Okay. There are some information you also bring to their attention and they work on. And make the relevant complaint. The FCC is here in Benin. ICPC is here. All the organizations are here. Don't be politically motivated. Don't allow the politicians to use you. But what you are seeing is what you are seeing. And if what you are seeing is not clear enough, ask for clarification. If your representative is not doing enough, write to the speaker. The speaker is not doing enough. Write to the government. You don't get response. Write to the FCC or the relevant agency. They are ready to work. They are here to work for their money.
All right. Thank you very much. Very enlightening moment I've had with Barrister Prest Agboha, who is the Executive Director, Freedom of Information Council, giving us some very useful perspectives on budget impacts in Nigeria and key challenges. Barrister Prest, thanks a lot for coming on the program.
Thank you
so much.